Hi dear students, welcome to the class. Today I am Naresh. I am going to be your faculty for data interpretation, logical reasoning as well as quantitativity. I am an IIM Bangalore alumnus and I hope you find it interesting to learn a lot of interesting concepts through my classes. Hoping to see you write to me in mail as well as interact with me over mails. Today we are actually try to help you understand what is puzzle solving and how does it actually work for us and what kind of things are tested within the first area called LR or puzzle solving. A lot of times when puzzle solving is taught, not just in CAT course, any other course, people find it amusing, you know, because the way puzzles are being learned right from childhood. I'm sure some of you would have done some magazines, weekly magazines of different newspapers, different news weeklies, etc., where you kind of do some puzzles here and there. When it comes to some of you who are in college currently, would have been preparing for your campus recruitments, you would have prepared on areas like ages, blood relations, directions, etc., coding, decoding, etc. And those who are in jobs also, you would have done all this when you kind of tried getting into jobs. But please understand, with respect to CAT syllabus, we at Abhyas would not do puzzle solving like ages, like blood relations, like directions, etc. We are not trying to say they are unimportant, but what we are saying is that's not the right approach. It's a wrong approach. Because this approach that people use to learn for CAT is assuming that puzzles would be asked only from these areas, these types of puzzles. No, CAT does not have the history of asking questions on ages, questions on blood relations, questions on directions directly. CAT does test the ability to make decisions through logical reasoning, through puzzle solving, and hence they don't use this approach. They use a completely different approach. The puzzles that are given here are usually complex and they might have multiple scenarios to be built in, and hence it is imperative that you are not going to just limit yourself to the classical areas that you have in analytical reasoning books that you can read through. You need to understand more. So what are the other important thing is CAT usually tests you on a puzzle which is sometimes disguised in a table format. For example, they might give you a table with some missing data and then expect you to fill the data. While it is not a mathematical or a chart data interpretation question, it's actually a puzzle solving question. So with this kind of thing, we need to have an approach based puzzle solving. We have to have an approach. The first thing is types. We can't use types, that's wrong, but we better use. What is the right thing to do then? The right thing to do is puzzle solving has to be done through an approach. What is the right approach to puzzle solving? If you can look at your class sheet today, the DL1 sheet that you would have, in the session objectives that we have for today, the first thing that you would see is, the first objective for today you actually would see is the three rules of puzzle solving. I would want you to now open your notebooks, seriously make a good note of what we are going to do in this slide. Now this is something that we believe is a very very useful technique that Abhyas team has put together. The three rules of puzzle solving. So instead of saying what are the different types of puzzles that we need to prepare for, we will kind of train you to solve any puzzle using three steps or three rules, very very simple rules. We'll have step number one, rule number one, or step two, rule two, or step three, rule three. Once we are able to master these three rules, three steps of puzzle solving, believe me, puzzle solving then becomes easier. You need not look at what types of puzzles, you rather look at mastering this technique of puzzle solving. Now the moment I say solve puzzles, lot of times I have students who believe that they are good puzzle solvers. In fact, how many of you like Sudoku? How many of you solve Sudoku? Right? I mean, if I ask you to kind of, can you please raise your hands, how many of you solve Sudoku? Right? I'm sure you look around, you might have some of you who do Sudoku that comes in a newspaper, etc. In fact, I have this. My father is extremely has a huge penchant for Sudokus. Have interest for Sudoku so much that the moment he sees a Sudoku, he has to do it wherever he is. Now, lot of times when you solve a Sudoku, I see two approaches. I see amateurish approach. I see a professional approach. Right? People who try to place a number and try to fill the box, and after a while they understand that the premise with which they started is wrong, and hence they do what? They kind of cut. They kind of cut the numbers, right? I mean, you start with something, but then you cut the entire thing, start again. That kind of approach is not a puzzle solving approach, but it is a puzzle guessing approach. So lot of you, when you think you solve puzzles, you are not doing puzzle solving, but you are doing puzzle guessing. Puzzle guessing is a very, very wrong approach. You actually are expected to learn puzzle solving. I want you to be a puzzle solver. As an Abhyas student, as my student, I would want a student to rather solve a puzzle than guess a puzzle. Never ever try to guess something in a puzzle, because if you start getting used to guessing in puzzles, believe me, you would not really make a good job of yourself. I have seen so many students, actually, when they do CAT exam, come out, they believe they have solved a puzzle, they come out, they get wrong answers because instead of solving it, they guess something. So, what is the basic difference between a puzzle guessing and a puzzle solver? Let's understand the difference. The difference, as we have learned just now, is puzzle guessers try to assume something and then fit a case and assume that's the answer. But a puzzle solver would not do that. Puzzle solver would eliminate all possible options. They would make sure that this is the only case that would work, because if it's a puzzle guesser, you got one answer, but there could be multiple answers. You need to be extremely cautious about that. And another fallacy, another issue, another gap that you would have with respect to being a puzzle guesser is you would waste tremendous amount of time. Complex puzzles sometimes which are asked, you would waste tremendous amount of time if you start guessing, because you guess one scenario, it goes wrong in the last minute, you have to start with the second. That's not an ideal approach. So never ever be a puzzle guesser, be a puzzle solver. That's the first mantra for today. So how does one become a puzzle solver? What do we do about it? What are the things that we need to do? Here, as I told you already, for us, we have three simple rules. Three simple rules. Let's get started with the rule number one. Rule number one is actually the simplest rule of the three, and at the same time, most profound, most powerful rule, and mostly neglected by puzzle solvers, and hence they don't do it well. Let me kind of write the first rule on the board, make a quick note of it, then we'll discuss. The first rule says that identify the main structure. Very, very important. Please note this. Identify the main structure. A good puzzle solver, the moment one reads the puzzle, they identify the main structure. Lot of students I've seen have the habit of, the moment you read one line of the question, you start noting something. A good puzzle solver would never put pen on paper until and unless you completely read the puzzle, understand what the puzzle is about, what data is given, what data is asked, and what is the best way to represent the given data, what is the best structure, best format to represent the given data. For example, if there's a question on blood relations as a type of puzzle, the best format, the best structure, the main structure to represent the data would be to create a family tree with gender based, you have a different shape for different gender, you have different level for different generations, etc. If you have something like directions, a very good format to use is actually a flowchart. If you have questions on, if you have a lot of questions on variables, for example, five friends do five different types of activities, play different five sports, have five different favorite actors, etc. These kind of things are variable or attribute based puzzles. The best structure to use for these kind of puzzles is tabular format. So, the first step for you, the moment you get any puzzle, the moment you read any puzzle, is to read the puzzle in entirety, understand what is given, understand what is asked, and decide, identify, analyze, and finalize a main structure, a format that you would want to use to represent the data given in the puzzle. Very, very, very important. Right? I mean, I'll kind of equate this to something that you would have done in childhood, right? Many of you would have played this game where we have a picture cut into many different pieces, people bring it together, etc. Now that game could be started from the end. There are different people, you know, that for example you have a Dhonika picture cut into 1,000 pieces and you have to bring it together to make it a complete picture. Right? This game is very, very popular with kids. When you are very young, you would have done this. Now this picture, when it has to be brought together to make a one complete picture, how can one start? I've seen many kids start many different ways. I find it very amusing to see kids doing this. One kid starts from one corner. Another kid says, I would want to start from the place where there's a face. I mean, another kid says, I want to start from the central part of the picture. Everyone has a different approach. Everyone has a different approach. Everyone has a different format. So similarly, as a master puzzle solver, you would, as rule number one, 50% of your success depends on deciding, identifying the main structure for the puzzle you are trying to solve. Very, very, very important. Please don't worry, we will understand how to apply this when we do questions. We have a very interesting exercise ahead. We'll do that. Now, what is the second rule then? What is the second rule? Rule number two is extremely simple. It says, please note it again. I'm making a note on the board. First make a note, then we'll discuss. Differentiate between sure event and unsure event. A lot of times I've seen, let me go back to the same Sudoku example that I've used earlier in my class. What happens? I've seen people start, say, they see a particular column or a row and say, this particular cell can have a 4 or 5 and hence we'll start with the 4, doesn't work, you eliminate everything, start with the 5 again. But, lot of times, once you decided a main structure for your puzzle, a very important tool, an important step, an important rule that a good puzzle solver would use is, every clue that is being presented in the puzzle. What is puzzle? Puzzle is all about, take some clues, identify what is asked. Given data, clues, and identify based on what is given, and you are asked some questions. So simply, puzzles are all about clues. And the clues could be two types. Sure events, unsure events, are direct and indirect clues. Now, the moment you get to know that in a particular box, either 4 could come or a 5 could come, for me, it is an unsure event. It is an indirect event. You are not still sure whether it is only 4 or only 5. And hence, you would not put a 4 in the Sudoku table. That is an approach of a good puzzle solver. A puzzle solver would never let data or a clue come into the structure until and unless one is sure about that particular data. Whereas a guesser would try to put in data even if it is unsure, even if it is indirect, even if it is incomplete, and try it. And inadvertently, they'll fail in the end. Whereas a good puzzle solver does not let a clue, a data come into the main structure until and unless it is complete, until and unless it is direct, and until and it is sure. Very, very, very important. This again, you would see how this rule is very important. Many different clues are given in a puzzle, but which is a clue to start the entire problem with after you have made a structure? It's always the direct clue. It's always the sure clue. It's always the complete clue. That's very, very important for you to note. Now, before we get going on the exercise, the last rule, the last step of puzzle solving is extremely simple. I'm making a note. Make a note on your notebook also. Let us see. The last rule that we have in puzzle solving is, please note this, is read between the lines. Read between the lines. A lot of times when I kind of say this, students kind of jokingly tell me, sir, reading what is there in the lines itself is difficult. You ask me to read something between the lines. I see students making this, but please understand what we meant by read between the lines is that a lot of times there are hidden clues. Clues that are not directly given, but indirectly given. So getting those clues are important. I've seen every year after the CAT exam, during the CAT exam, that October to November season, students come out after the exam, talk to me and say, hey, sir, there's a puzzle which is wrong. There's a question that is given in CAT exam which is wrong. Believe me, I respect IIMs a lot. Having said that, I'm not saying they're foolproof, but what I'm saying is, 99% of the time when a student says that the question is wrong, I believe the exam setter more than you. The simple reason being, there is lot of data that is given in a hidden format, that's given in a format which is shrouded, and it is for you to read between the lines and get the gist of it. Let me kind of say something like this, right? There's a very famous saying in Telugu, I'll also convert it into English for your use. There's a saying says, Rajugari Modati Bharya Manchidi, or King's first wife is wise. When I say that, apart from the information it gives that the first queen is good, wise, solemn, etc., it also says, the indirect clue is, king has another wife. The indirect clue is, king has a wife who might not be as wise or who is not so intelligent. So, lot of times, when you read the puzzle, when you believe the puzzle is incomplete, the questions are being asked without enough data, that this rule number 3 should be kind of poking your head. Hey, you should understand, maybe there's a clue that is given in indirect manner. It is for you to unearth the clue and kind of use it in your structure to get the final answer. And believe me, that's it. If you have these 3 rules, this forms the total approach. It's a master approach that we use at Abhyas, and this is very, very, very popular. Master approach to solve any puzzle solving problem you would ever come across. Let us put this to use. You will see how we can use rule number 1, rule number 2, rule number 3 in real time puzzles. And as you would have known, there is one book that I suggest apart from the CAT prep in general. Someone who wants to be a good puzzle solver, if you are looking for some kind of reference book, I am changing the color, I am giving a reference book in green color. All of you would have read about Shakuntala Devi. Shakuntala Devi puzzles are good, but they are more calculative than data oriented. I would suggest you to definitely do a puzzles book called authored by George Summers. George Summers is the author. It's a very, very small book. In fact, if you want to have a look at the book, etc., you can ask the center. They'll give you a book. And those who are, it's not part of the course, you can always try and buy it. It's very cheap. So this is a book, Puzzles for You by George Summers. It's a wonderful book for you to do if you want to become a great puzzle solver and you can apply the rule that we have learned here. That's a wonderful book. Now today, what we will do is, having learned these things, let us actually go ahead and apply the rules that we have learned in the puzzles that we have. Always remember to apply the rules, and these are very, very interesting. In fact, DL1 is one of the most interesting exercises you have in the entire CAT syllabus at Abhyas. So, what we'll try and do is, we'll try to solve as many puzzles as possible in the time we have. So, first thing, get started. I'll give you 3 minutes. Start question number 1 and 2. Do question number 1 and 2. The puzzle of question number 1 and 2. Try do this. I'll give you 3 minutes time. Read it, try to solve it. please don't disturb each other. Focus on the class, focus on the puzzle. If you are unable to solve that, you can try, I'll explain it myself. Please don't worry. Right. Please stop. Let us try to do this question number 1 and 2. In fact, if you look at it, lot of you would have got answers already. It's a very easy puzzle. And some of you would have got the answer with guesswork, etc. I'm not really interested in the answer first, but I'm interested in the approach or the method. Let us see what is there in this puzzle and quickly decide, apply our rules. First, read through the puzzle before you put pen and paper. And let's try to summarize the given puzzle in, say, 2-3 sentences. What do I know? 4 friends, party, hat, coat, exchanged. Each one took hat and coat of different people. 4 friends, 2 items, who took whose hat and coat? That is the overall puzzle, if I have to kind of summarize it into short 2 sentences. And the questions are about Budgie's hat, coat taken by whom, etc., etc., etc. So what does it mean? If I can make, what should be the structure be? Because there are 4 people, there are 2 items, and because I want to decide who took whose hat and coat, I think a very good structure, very good format for us to put the data in is a table. Some of you would have done it orally because just 4 people, 2 items, you would have. But please understand, retaining data in memory or guessing is not a good idea. Always it's good to put things on paper once you read it. I have 4 people. So what I'll do is I'll put 4 lines, right? And what do I know? I have name of the person and a hat and a coat. So if for example I put Rakesh, I put Mohan and I put say Bhaji and I put say Laddu. What does it mean? Rakesh's hat is taken by whom? I need to put that. If I say Rakesh is R, Mohan is M, Bhaji is B, Laddu is L, Rakesh's hat is taken by someone, I'll put that letter here. Similarly, Rakesh's coat is taken by someone, I'll put that letter here. So, automatically I have 8 cells to be filled from the data that is given. And once I have the data, let us see what, this is rule number 1. I have applied the rule number 1, I have put the right structure. After this, the puzzle will become easy. Now, let us see what data. Do we have any clue that will help us fill the table? We have a huge paragraph, but decide which is a sure event. Again, second part of the paragraph is all clues, and I can see a lot of people reading Rakesh's coat taken was also taken by friend who took Mohan's hat. That's an example of a clue which is indirect. I would not say that's a great clue at this point of time. I am looking at a direct clue or a sure event. Let us see what is it. Mohan takes the coat belonging to friend whose hat is taken by Rakesh, again indirect clue. But the last line, read the last line carefully. Bhaji took Laddu's hat. That's a very, very useful hint. Let me say why. Bhaji took Laddu's hat. That means Laddu's hat, Laddu and hat taken by whom? Bhaji. That is B. I can fill this by B. Now that's a wonderful hint for us because the moment I have B is filled, I know B cannot come anywhere else under hat, particularly under Bhaji for sure. And this is the first clue that I can fill. Now let us see, are there any other useful hints. Now that the first hint, that is direct hint, is proven, let us see what else we have. Let me read this last but third or fourth line carefully. Rakesh Kot was taken. Rakesh Kot, I am saying this particular person, Rakesh Kot, was taken by the same person who took Mohan's hat. Mohan's hat, Rakesh Kot, taken by same person. Right, if I take a different color, let me just for the sake of highlighting, I'll say red color. What do I know? There is someone who has taken Rakesh Kot and Mohan's hat. That has to be the same person. That has to be the same person. Now this is a clue that is given, because there is no other clue that is really sure, really direct. We don't have who took whose. But can we do something about this? Hey, Rakesh Kot cannot be taken by Rakesh, so this cannot be R. The circles I am trying to fill with red color is not R. Mohan's hat cannot be taken by Mohan himself, because it's very clearly given no one has taken their own, taken someone else's hat and coat. Automatically it can't be M, it can't be R. It has to be either Laddu or Bajji, L or B. But B, as we discussed already, B is filled under hat. So the only thing left under hat now, leaving R and M, is Laddu. So Laddu is the person who has taken Mohan's hat, and the same Laddu has taken what? He's also taken coat of Rakesh. This is the first hint for us to fill. And once I have this, after this I can come back. Once Laddu is filled, Bajji is filled, Rakesh cannot be R. R cannot be R. The only thing that left is M. And automatically what is left over is R. Under hat, if I have to fill, I can fill it this way. The remaining hats, because R, M, L, B has to come once in hat, once in coat. Very simple. Let us look at the second one. The moment I know that Laddu has taken Rakesh, this thing, let us see what else can we fill. You can look at anyone else and you can fill this. In fact, we have another clue that you need not use, but still, let us kind of say. Mohan takes the coat belonging to the friend whose hat is taken by Rakesh. Hat taken by Rakesh is a Bajji. Automatically what happens? Mohan takes this person's coat. M comes here, and Mohan, M comes here. Automatically what happens? We are between Mohan and Laddu. We need to fill B. After this, let us see what happens. Who is the person that can come? Now, because Laddu's hat is already taken by Bajji, Laddu's coat cannot be B. B cannot come in the same row. Hence, this has to be R. Automatically, this has to be B. So, this is how quickly you can fill the table. Might look a little strenuous for those who have tried doing orally. I am telling you once again, see how simple it is if you put the right structure, apply the right clues. And once we have applied the clues, the beauty of this method is, here in these questions you have got asked about Bajji. But there could be a set where the questions are asked about something else. The questions could be anything else. So it is always useful for you to kind of do the complete table so that any question can be asked.